It's time for question. Thank you very much, members. I call Dr. Ratnam.
Thank you, President. President, my question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Consumer Affairs. Minister, with the federal COVID-19 disaster payments set to wind up in the coming weeks, thousands of Victorians will once again be pushed further into poverty. The rollback of the payments will affect thousands of low-income and casual workers who have already been struggling with reduced or no income and who overwhelmingly rent their homes. Although this government has given financial support to other parts of the community who have been struggling, such as small businesses, renters have largely been forgotten in this lockdown. Minister, will your government provide urgent additional financial support to renters so nobody will lose their home in a pandemic?
Yeah, thank you, President. And then thanks, Ms. Ratman, for her question. I will ensure that that question is passed on to the Minister for Consumer Affairs. And I note Ms. Ratman's concern around the challenges of people are renting. And I'm sure the Minister will take her question very seriously and give a response in line with the standing orders.
Dr. Ratman, on a supplementary.
Thank you very much, Minister, for following that up with the minister, relevant minister. Furthermore, with the backlog of VCAT exploding in recent weeks, especially in the residential tenancies list, it's clear that many landlords are still attempting to evict tenants for non-payment of rent. The existing rental reforms are not sufficient to prevent unfair evictions in the pandemic. Further, the recently announced rental relief grant scheme is so restrictive many renters in need cannot access it, and so stingy it barely covers 1 month's rent, let alone ongoing rent payments. Minister, to ensure individuals and families who are struggling financially in the pandemic are not kicked out of their homes, will you bring back the eviction moratorium?
Minister Lean.
Thank you, President, and thanks, Ms. Ratman, for a supplementary question, which is directed to the Minister for Consumer Affairs, and I will ensure she gets the supplementary question and the response is returned to this House and Ms. Ratman under the standing orders.
Thank you. Mr. Davis.
President, my question is to the Minister for Small Business. Minister Tiny Good of Showtech, a rigging and lighting company that supports shows by international touring acts, ballet, opera, even musicals, employed 80 people but has now lost at least 8 employees who have left the event sector. Mr. Good has said the Victorian State Government roadmap has made reopening for events before Christmas less likely. He's continued in his comments and said, "I love to know what event the Andrews government thinks it is going to open under the guidelines this side of Christmas, because you won't have indoor concerts, exhibitions, large-scale business meetings. So if by events they mean sporting events, then they need to get their heads read. So I ask you, Minister, on what date will events companies like Tiny Goods company Showtech be able to return to the events sector they love?"
Minister, I will give you the chance, but I think it's for the sport minister, not small bit. But anyway, thank you. Minister.
Yeah, thank you, President. I thank Mr. Davis for his question, and I will endeavour to answer this. But yes, a business with 80 employees probably exceeds just about any definition you can think of small business. But And the events sector is predominantly the responsibility of the Minister for Tourism and Major Events. But of course, I'm sure that Showtech involve themselves in smaller events as well. But I'll, in my capacity representing Minister Bakula, I'll endeavour to provide the best answer that I can. So there has been a whole lot of different sector-specific support programs in addition to the broader and more generally available programs for business support. Mr. Davis's question was very much about the roadmap and Victoria's and the government and the public health team's delivery of the national plan to reopen the economy. Mr. Davis is asking for a precise date, and of course a precise date depends on the vaccine rollout speed, and I'm sure, like many other people in the chamber and in the community, we're reasonably obsessively checking the vax dates on a daily basis. More than 90,000 people in Victoria, indeed an MCG's worth of people on many days in recent times, and the vax rollout now really has hit a great pace, which is a relief, and also it is exciting. So Moderna in pharmacies now, which is terrific. Programs to particularly target communities that have been a little slower than others to jump into the opportunities that present and roll out. And indeed, Mr. Jepp and I share a border which takes in the magnificent community of Bull Oak. Now, I don't think they can lay claim to top of the league table. I think that's our old mates in Queenscliff. Yeah. But you know, the number of communities that have now hit 90% single dose that are hitting starting to hit 70 and greater numbers double dose gives us all great help, and everyone in the entire community is to be commended for the role that they're playing in getting the events industry reopen when we get to that 80% double dose rate. And so the roadmap foreshadows this as being on or around the 5th of November. I like to optimistically think we might beat that by a few days. The fact that the advice for spacing of Pfizer doses has now changed from 6 weeks to 3, you know, gives me some hope that we might be able to do that sooner. And the roadmap provides for those...
Time, Minister. Thank you. Mr. Davies on a supplementary.
I thank the Minister for her answer. The events sector, of course, is replete with so many small businesses, some of them extremely small businesses that have been hit very hard. And the Save Victorian Events Group, and Simon Thewlis as the spokesperson, has said if the Victorian Government doesn't act quickly, very quickly, there will be very few events happening in Victoria until well into 2022. And I ask, given the large number of small businesses in the events sector, will the Minister meet with Mr. Thewlis this week to hear about his plan for an events-led recovery?
Minister Poulton.
Thank you. Now, as I was going to say before, I was defeated by the clock. There will be numbers depending on the settings in the hundreds at that phase in the roadmap at 80% or greater. And of course, all peak bodies that the government deals with and works with closely are well aware of these things. So entertainment venues will be able to have outdoor seated entertainment, will be able to have the lesser of 25% or 5,000 people fully vaccinated. Hospitality venues, which obviously cater for many different types of smaller events, will be able to have, and I'm looking at the roadmap here, I mean, this is public, everybody should be well aware of these, will be able to have 150 outdoors and 150 indoors, subject to density quotients of 4 and 2 indoors and outdoors.
Thank you, your time. Thank you.
Hasn't gone anywhere near answering the question of whether she'll meet.
Time finished. Thank you. Minister, your time expired. Ms. Thiene on a minister statement.
Every Victorian should have the chance to get a job that they want, no matter their background, identity or gender. That is why I was proud to launch the $5 million Women in Apprenticeships initiative last week. It will remove barriers for women who want a rewarding career in traditionally male-dominated trades like plumbing, electrical, aviation and IT. Among the first 10 programs in the initiatives is a 30 pre-apprenticeships for women in electrical, pathways for women to join the aviation industry, and a program to help women facing financial difficulties in the rail industry. And that's not all. The programs also provide hands-on experience, wage support, peer support and mentorships, career pathways for school leavers and online sessions and workshops. Women in Apprenticeships will support 615 women into pre-apprenticeships, traineeships and apprenticeships, and create a strong, diverse pipeline of skilled workers for Victoria's Big Build. The new initiative will be life-changing for Victorian women of all backgrounds and at all stages of their career. The response has already been resounding. Victorian women want a rewarding career in trades to help build their future. We've already seen a significant number of EOIs in the Big Build Apprenticeships program that have been submitted by women, and the Women in Apprenticeships initiative will only boost that number. we are backing women who want jobs in trades. And I encourage anyone who is finishing school, looking for a job, or wants a career change to explore their future in trades at Apprenticeships Victoria at their website. Thank you, President.
Thank you. Mr. Limbrick.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Small Business. The Premier recently announced that all authorised workers will be required to be vaccinated, although as of this morning, no mandatory vaccination directions were published on the Department of Health website. This announcement has sent many employers and workers into a panic. They're unsure what to do for staff if staff either refuse to be vaccinated or refuse to hand over their medical details. Many of these workers are highly valued staff that the employer does not want to sack. What are you advising employers to do if staff refuse to either be vaccinated or hand over their private medical details?
Mr. Pulford.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Limbrick for his question, and I know that he has an audience and attracts an audience that are vehemently opposed to the scientific basis of the vaccination program that is the thing between us and an open economy. And I think that
you're enabled.
I would encourage you to reflect on how people interpret your appearance at public events,
Minister,
like the riots
Minister,
at the union
you.
Office
thank
a
you.
Couple of weeks ago.
Minister, thank you. Mr. David on a point of order.
Minister Stitt accused Mr. Limbrick of being a right-wing extremist. That's how I heard what she said. Now, I don't know whether he heard it, but that is what I heard, and I don't think it's right.
Yes.
Look, order. Mr. David, I know I heard you clearly, but Mr. Limbrick is in a chamber, and I didn't hear anything. I don't know if Mr. Limbrick, he didn't raise a point of order. I don't know if he heard it or heard nothing. But thank you. Minister, to continue.
Thank you. Look, I know these are issues about which people in the community have strong feelings. The need for us to open up, in a considered and thoughtful way that is cognizant of our obligations to ensure that people in the Victorian community who need help from our hospitals and our health services can access it while we open up. And I know that half the people in this room and half the people in the community reckon the roadmap's too slow and the other half reckon it's too fast, which maybe makes it about the right pace. In response to Mr. Limbrick's question about businesses that have staff members that do not want to be vaccinated, my answer is precisely the same answer I gave Mr. Davis. I would encourage those businesses to talk to their staff about the importance of vaccination and the relationship to that business's ability to trade and participate in a busier and more active economy. I would encourage those businesses to think about it, whether it's within their capacity to facilitate time off to go and be vaccinated. And I would encourage them to reach out to their peak organisations for support and advice about the way in which these things engage with industrial relations law. As for organisations that have staff shortages and skills shortages, because this tiny percentage of the community would rather ignore science and put themselves and their workmates at risk, that small percentage of our community, for employers that need to replace those people in their workplaces, I would encourage them to familiarise themselves with the supports that are available through the Jobs Victoria program that I administer in my employment portfolio, and we will do everything we can to assist them, also working with PEEKS, to find staff that are wanting to work.
Mr. Limbrick on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. Take this off. If an employer decides that they must reluctantly sack a staff member due to a mandate, what protections are there for those employers in this situation against things such as unfair dismissal or other legal actions that may be taken against them?
Sir,
Thank you. So this I would make the point that this is outside my area of training and portfolio responsibilities in a very direct sense, because you're asking about Commonwealth industrial relations laws. No, he asked about unfair dismissal and Commonwealth industrial relations laws. So there are things I know about this, but I think in the... as we all do. I mean, you used to be,
you know,
in industrial relations too, in your own way. But my answer to the question is that these are very, very particular instances, and in a circumstance where an employer has to performance manage an employer, they need to seek appropriate advice from someone more qualified and trained to provide this to them than I am. But again, I think the best thing they can do is have that conversation about the benefits of vaccination.
Dr. Bard.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Veterans. Minister, in 1965, an avenue of honour with nine trees was planted by local residents of Mont Albert in Churchill Street. It was established in honour of the four Head brothers, William, Fawcett, Roland and Gordon, and five of their mates, hence the nine trees, all of whom enlisted in the Great War from that community, with William tragically losing his life at the Gallipoli landings on April 25 in 1915. Minister, what steps will you take to ensure that your colleague, the Minister for Transport Infrastructure, Jacinta Allen in the other place, and her agency, the LXRP, do not clear fell these nine Anzac trees as part of their overzealous removal of trees associated with the Surry Hills and Mont Albert level crossing removals?
Minister Lean.
Thank you. I thank Dr. Bark for his question and his interest over this particular issue. Now, it's my understanding that these particular trees don't necessarily aren't acknowledged as an avenue of honour by the RSL and also a number of other authorities that do usually acknowledge this type of structure. But I do understand that there is a local interest and some locals that have some understanding of the history of these particular trees. I'm happy, Mr. Bark, to get more information around these particular trees and maybe do some more research and get some more research done on the history. And I'm happy to have conversations with any individuals or groups that want to have a conversation with me about these particular trees.
Thank you, Dr. Bark, on a supplementary.
Thank you. And I thank the Minister for his response. Minister, the trees in this avenue of honour in Churchill Street currently have red and white tape wrapped around them, which has caused real concern that the decision may already have been made and that they'll be removed, despite what I'm informed by local residents is a lack of consultation. Now, I thank you for your response to me and your willingness to meet with my constituents. Given their concern, and if indeed it is your determination, Minister, that this is a legitimate avenue of honour, can I ask what actions will you take with your colleague in the other place in effort to save these trees?
Oh, Dr. Bark, thank you, President, and thank Dr. Bark for his supplementary question. Dr. Bark, I'm committed to avail myself more of any information around these particular trees. I can't make a commitment either way as far as how this particular situation may go forward. And getting back to that, I do understand that there is, the RSL and other groups that usually authorise it. These particular trees are of significance, historical significance to the veterans community. Haven't acknowledged that. I'm still happy to put into consideration and have conversations with any of my colleagues. But in saying that, Dr. Bark, I don't want to give any false premise that I will give the answer to your residents that they particularly are looking for.
Thank you, Minister Statement. Mr. Steet.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on how the Andrews Labor Government is helping our youngest learners get the best start in life by making local kindergartens inclusive for children of all abilities, with facility upgrades, specialist equipment and state-of-the-art technology. Last month, I announced more than $3 million in the Building Blocks grants to help over 800 kindergartens improve learning outcomes for every young Victorian child. The investment includes $2.4 million in the latest round of Building Blocks inclusion grants, supporting 242 kindergartens to upgrade their facilities or purchase equipment to provide a safe and inclusive learning environment for children of all needs and abilities. Upgrades include infrastructure in playgrounds to make kinder activities more accessible, as well as movable inclusive education equipment like mobility stools and sensory equipment to support learning programs. A further 569 kindergartens will also receive IT grants of up to $1,500 from the latest round of building block improvement grants, funding sharing more than $796,000 in total for this support. These IT grants are so important to our early childhood centres and will help pay for new equipment such as computers, iPads and interactive TV aids that can be used for administration or to help deliver learning programs. Ensuring that all children can fully participate in their kinder is an absolute priority for our government. That's why it's so crucial that we upgrade facilities and equip them with the modern technology to create safe, inclusive and interactive learning environments, and that's exactly what this investment will do.
Thank you, Mr. Grimley.
Thanks, President. So my question is for the Attorney General. The Victims Charter Act seeks to improve the experience of victims of crime by providing statutory recognition for them while setting out the minimum standards for responses across criminal justice and government agencies. The original bill was passed more than 15 years ago with bipartisan support, but a lack of remedy for victims of crime in cases where agencies fail to meet the charter principles, as noted in the second reading speeches. Despite recommendations by the VLRC in 2016 to institute such remedies, the charter remains a toothless tiger. In other words, there is no penalty or consequence for agencies who do not meet compliance within the charter. Ensuring compliance with the Act becomes essential to minimise the risk that victims may be subject to as secondary victims within the criminal justice system. Attorney, how can the Victims Charter Act be strengthened to ensure that it is not a toothless tiger?
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Grimley for his question. That's a big question. I was around in government 15 years ago when we introduced this, and it was a really good advancement in the recognition of victims in our criminal justice system and how we can do better to respond to and support them through the process, which often sidelines them, as we know, given that the consequences are for offenders and victims are not necessarily always given the attention that they deserve. I'm pleased to say that in the 15 years since the Charter's been in place, there has been vast improvements, much investment. We now have dedicated Minister for Victim Support, and we also have the Victims of Crime Commissioner. I have had conversations with her about the Victims Charter and her role and how it intersects with the department, and I agree with you. I think we can continue to strengthen that, and that's part of my reasonably new role as Attorney General to have a close look at further improvements going forward.
Mr. Grimley, on a supplementary.
Thanks, President. Thanks, Attorney General. It's very pleasing to hear. If we go specifically to Section 21 of the Victims Charter Act, it requires you, Attorney, to cause the Department of Justice to include in its annual report information about the steps taken to promote the Charter principles and also a report on the operation of this Act. From our reading of recent annual reports, despite the word victim popping up every now and then, there is no specific or significant coverage of the functionality or effectiveness of the Victims Charter Act in these annual reports. Again, in other words, it seems these reporting requirements are not being met. Darren Hinch's Justice Party would like to see the obligations under Section 21 fulfilled explicitly in these reports. My supplementary question is, Attorney, can you explain how you and the Department meet the reporting requirements of Section 21 of the Victims Charter Act?
Attorney General.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Grimley for his question. Indeed, appreciate that you've made prior inquiries about this, which enabled me to have a look at it. Section 21 does require reporting on the operation of the promotion of the Victims Charter, and it's effectively achieved by a number of ways. The Victim Service Agency within the Department actively promote the Charter through its website and informs victims of their entitlements. The Victims of Crime Commissioner obviously was brought in after the Victims Charter, they also, or she also, plays a critical role in promoting the Victims Charter, ensuring justice agencies abide by its principles and treat victims with dignity, courtesy and respect. In 2019, we further strengthened the Commissioner's powers to require agencies to report annually on their compliance with the Charter to her. The Commissioner then reports on this compliance in her annual report, which is tabled in Parliament. She also reports on on the number, type and outcome of complaints that she has received in relation to the Charter. This certainly gives Parliament and the community a clear line of sight on how agencies are performing on their obligations in relation to the Charter.
Good one. Mr. Ondaatje.
Thank you, President. Good afternoon. My question is to the Minister for Training and Skills. Demand for solar installation on buildings in Victoria continues to grow. This demand has driven a strict safety requirement need and to ensure the highest rates of compliance for the solar industry, to keep households and workers safe, and to crack down on dodgy solar installers. One option available is to ensure we upskill electricians to become licensed electrical inspectors, LEIs. To become an LEI, eligible candidates must successfully complete 3 separate assessments and apply for a licence through Energy Safe Victoria. The government outlined a plan for this on the 31st of March 2021. Minister, who has the government appointed as a training organisations to provide direct solar skill development and training for current LEI applicants during the LEI training phase?
Thank you, President. This is a matter that falls also within the remit of Minister D'Ambrosio, but can I say the following to you? That this, amongst a number of training issues to do with clean energy, is very much part of an important focus that this government has. We are about to announce the composition of the Clean Energy Task Force, and that will be announced very shortly. The chair of that will be the newly established founding chair of, or CEO of, the Victorian Skills Authority, Craig Robertson. And they have already determined their meeting agenda. Coupled with that, the Victorian Skills Authority will be furnished with the task, and is furnished with the task, of providing me with a statewide, first ever statewide training skills plan for the entire
Thank
state.
Thank you, Minister. Mr. Ondaatje, on a point
of order. And it goes to relevance, President. This is a very narrow question. Very simple question and required just a very simple answer. This minister comes in here and tells us she is the person who's turned the training system around. It's a very simple question. Who has the government appointed as training organisations around LEIs? Very
Thank
simple.
Thank you. The minister still got nearly 2 minutes. Minister.
Thank you. And so this is a government that is making sure that in terms of where there are shortages, where there are needs, that the voices of industry is being heard, and we are making sure that we have got the most aligned and listened to system that is agile and flexible. And in terms of the particular question that Mr. Ondaatje is requesting, this is a matter that is dealt with by the Department of Training, as well as with the Minister for Minister D'Ambrosio. So we have got a lot of work that has been done, a lot of work that will continue to be done, but I can assure Mr. Ondaatje that it is this government and this government alone, not those across the road that wouldn't have a clue what is going on in industry and what the skill requirements are in this state, in particular in the clean energy economy. And I look forward to your criticism of the composition of the task force. And don't be so patronising, Mr. Ondaatje. Your attitude towards women and other things is absolutely reprehensible.
Thank you. Thank you. Order.
Precious kettle.
Mr. Ondaatje, on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. This from a minister who waxes lyrical in ministerial statements that she's the saviour of the training industry
and can't
answer a simple question.
Thank you, Mr. Ondaatje.
My supplementary.
Mr. Ondaatje, thank you. Ms. Stepstra, on a point of order.
Thank you, Mr. President. Look, I believe Ms. Crozier made an unparliamentary remark directed at the minister and told her that she should get out of the kitchen and called her a precious petal, and I ask that she withdraw that remark.
Order. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There's no point of order. We'll continue. Mr. Ondaatje.
Thank you. Thank you, President. Given the Minister couldn't simply tell us who's doing the training, albeit she's the Minister for Training, Minister, since the government's solar training announcement, how many new LEIs have passed the LEI solar skills test in your capacity as Minister for Training and Skills?
Thank you, President. And yes, this is a specific question that Mr. Ondaatje asks. This is a question that should be directed to the Minister for the Environment and Climate Change. And in terms of providers in this state, there are hundreds of providers in this state across a whole range of areas. It is absolutely impossible for me to have that level of detail in front of me, and you know that, Mr. Ondaatje. But in terms of the answer to this question, I'm happy to take that on notice, Mr. Ondaatje, and see whether Minister Ambrosio can provide some assistance in this area. Mr. Ondaatje.
Thank you. Thank you. Minister's statement, Minister Lane.
Thank you, President. I'd like to update the House on the Suburban Revitalisation Program in the great suburb of Noble Park. The Victorian Government will invest $1.1 million in Ian and Frank Street's project. Ian Street project will deliver new lighting, street furniture, landscaping, as well as relocation of power lines along the retail and dining strip. Frank Street project will build a pocket park and create greener connections between Ross Reserve, Albury Moss Memorial Gardens and Coppice Park. And I want to thank the City of Dandenong for their contribution as well. Our government has invested in over $25 million in the past 15 months for new revitalisation projects, partnering with local government, community organisations across 115 projects. And that's delivered $73.8 million of co-investment across Melbourne's suburbs. We're investing in community spaces in Noble Park to bring people together and make this their much-loved area a better place to live. I'd like to thank the Noble Park Revitalisation Board and also the incredible hard-working Chair Lee Talamas MP. Fantastic MP. And also the other MP that's involved in the geographical area, the member for Mulgrave. He goes all right. Remember from Mulgrave, doesn't he? He goes all right. It's like throwing raw meat into a cage, isn't it? I knew that. Exactly what I expected. So thank you, President.
Mr. Hayes.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to the Minister representing the Treasurer. On the 7th of September, a report was tabled in this House. The report I refer to is Report Number 1, January 2021 to 30th of June 2021, of Foreign Purchases Additional Duty Exemptions under Section 3E of the Duties Act 2000. It indicated 12 exemptions were granted worth over $38 million. Can the Treasurer give details on who was granted the 12 exemptions and for what particular purchases the exemptions were granted?
Mr. Symes.
Thank you, President, and thank Mr. Hayes for his question to the Treasurer. A very specific question. I'll seek advice from his office and respond accordingly.
Mr. Hayes on a supplementary.
Thank you, Minister, and thanks, President. My supplementary question is, can the Treasurer inform me why wouldn't this $38 million of additional duty, which was exempted for these foreign purchases, be better spent on constructing much-needed social housing and providing funding for homeless services for needy and low-income Victorians?
Mr. Symes.
Thank you, President. I'll also pass on the supplementary question to the Minister for the Treasurer in the other place, but I would point out this government's record in social housing and public housing and the big build announcements that involve significant amounts of money, and I think in this space you can always spend more, but I'm very proud of this government's investment to deal with homelessness and people at risk of homelessness.
Mr. David.
President, my question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, last week the United Firefighters Union launched a disrespectful and dishonest advertising campaign designed to create fear and further destroy the reputation of CFA volunteers. Fire Rescue Commissioner and mate of the UFU's Peter Marshall, Ken Block, has backed the campaign. And I therefore ask, Minister, do you and government policy support this disrespectful and dishonest campaign?
Thank you, President, and happy to respond to Mr. Davis's question in my capacity as Minister for Emergency Services. It's a fantastic honour to be appointed as the Minister for Emergency Services. Victoria has a world-class complementary fire service with fantastic people, and that's the reason that I'm very happy to take on this role. I'm certainly not in the business of dictating to others, whether it be unions or anyone else, about how they should communicate to the community. However, if I was a UFU, this is not the way I would choose to communicate in the way that they have done, but it is ultimately a fundamentally a matter for the UFU. I am extremely proud of the efforts of all of our firefighters, whether they be career or volunteer members. They're highly trained, they provide world-class complementary service to our community, and often at great risk of personal... great risk of their own personal health and safety. The substance of the UFU's campaign directs communities to the Fire District Review Panel, which has commenced a legislative four-year review process that will be completed by June 2024. The Fire District Review Panel has been established in legislation to independently advise on whether any changes in fire risk require changes to the fire district boundaries. And I certainly welcome any community engagement in relation to this conversation. The review is ongoing. Many members of the community will have views in relation to this. There'll be factors that the panel consider, including population growth, service demand and land use. I look forward to seeing this work progress and continuing to focus on ensuring that our fire services meet the demands of community, regardless of where they live in Victoria now and into the future.
On the supplementary.
Well, President, members of the Chamber will be aware that volunteer firefighters in the CFA are the lifeblood of many local communities around Victoria. They're teachers, tradesmen, office workers, single parents, students, until they put their uniform on to serve their community. And I note that you've said that it is not the way I would choose to communicate. And in that spirit, I wonder whether you will commit to meet with volunteer representatives to hear how much this divisive campaign is tearing them apart.
And how I am.
I live in Broadford. Where do you live? Right? I speak with volunteers in the supermarket quite regularly. My email has been filled with emails of people that have views on this thing. I have spent the last 6 years of being the member for Northern Victoria travelling around country areas, and there's not many areas where you don't meet a firefighter. I'll continue to do so.
Minister statement. Minister Pulford.
Thank you so much, President. On Monday, it was my enormous pleasure to launch the government's new social enterprise strategy, developed in partnership with our wonderful social enterprise sector. It is the largest sector in Australia, with more than 3,500 enterprises across the state. Social enterprises are embedded in our communities and in our lives, in sport and recreation, in retail, food service, across our health and social services. And we're committed to supporting this wonderful sector through the Social Enterprise Strategy 2021 to 2025. Key themes include building skills and capabilities, increasing access to appropriate financing, strengthening connections between social enterprises across Victoria, and supporting social enterprises through government procurement. I'd like to thank our social enterprises for their engagement in this strategy. In particular, I'd like to thank Jane Garrett for her work in chairing the reference group, and extend a special thank you to all reference group members, including Cinnamon Evans, Joe Barrickett, Wade Noonan, Matt Farlett, Rebecca Scott, Kevin Robbie, Hannah Ebling, Colin Stimpson, Rona Glyn McDonald, Nick Verginis, Lisa Waldron and Mike McKinstry. In her role as Parliamentary Secretary, I know that Ms. Garrett has very much enjoyed working with the sector. This strategy is theirs, and she and I share the sector's excitement about next steps as we now work to implement this and to see our social enterprise strategy that grows jobs and grows communities flourish over coming years. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes question time.